out this morning. Beautiful day, could be doing other things, but thanks for coming to participate in the town meeting. For announcements, I'm going to turn the podium over to Kelly, who's one of our able town manager assistants. Kelly Hill.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So out in the lobby area and in the hallway, I would encourage you all to visit the tables. We have the energy committee out there that has information on electric vehicles. Safe Line is out there, and they have a bunch of information about becoming an advocate. The Census Bureau is out there. Anyone looking for a job, they are in desperate need of employees. The Rec Committee has information out there on the skate park and other information. The Zandy, the Conservation Commission, is answering questions about the Mike Builder property, the 428 Pleasant Street, and they're actually trying to find ideas on names for that property and what everybody would like to see it used for. The BRI has sign-ups for Bethel University, and I don't know if any of you have seen the list of classes, but there's a ton of great classes out there they're offering this year. The Historical Society and Gifford has a survey that's going around. If you want to try to catch up with Marilyn Pratt, she's got the Historical Society surveys, and what they're doing is they're trying to do a book on the history of the people in Bethel, and they're looking for old photographs, names, any kind of information anybody can offer. And of course, the pie table is out there. And I would just like to say a quick comment. Laura Rubinus, who recently passed away, started the pie table. And she was a great lady that dedicated a lot of her energy and time to the town. So if you all have a chance, eat a piece of pie and remember that great lady for all that she was and what she did for the town of Bethel. Lastly, I have something. This is for our town manager, Therese Kirby. She has taken this job on with great power and wisdom and has conquered every hurdle from her way. And we all just wanted to say how much we appreciate you and thank you for the fabulous job that you've done. So before Therese kills me for that, I would also like to mention that we have several committees that need volunteers. Most of the committees only meet once a month and for about an hour. Some are actually on an as-needed basis. So the Conservation Commission table has a sign-up sheet, and there's a brief description on what each committee does. So if you have love for this town like I do, we would appreciate any volunteers that come forward. The DRB is one of the committees, the Rec Committee, and the Planning Commission. They're all looking for volunteers. So we hope you guys have a chance to take a look and any information you need. We're happy to answer questions at the town manager's office. But have a great day, and thank you for coming out.
Okay, on the table at the center in the rear, there are extra town reports. There are paper ballots. Well, we have several items that most likely will be by paper ballot. So make sure you have a few of those. Everyone who is a registered voter needs to have a badge, a blue badge. If you're a visitor, it says visitor at the top. Only registered voters are allowed to participate as far as voting and speaking, unless we have given permission. So make sure you have checked in at the back of the gym. Also on the table back there, there are a couple of items. There's the trash ordinance, a copy of that, which we will be discussing later. There's also a replacement Article 13, we'll talk about that later, that was not fully printed in the town report. So also, I wanted to mention the Bethel Operator's Manual. This has been about a 5-year project by the town meeting committee. It's now at the printers. We had hoped to have it ready today, but despite our best efforts, it was not available. However, it will be later this week. It's going to be available at the town offices. At this point, we've printed roughly enough for one per household. So later this week or next week, if you feel so inclined, stop by the town clerk's office, get your copy. We'll have some available at some other events throughout the spring to get those out. This is a very comprehensive manual of everything about Bethel. It's good for new folks as well as us older folks. So don't hesitate to pick up a copy. Just a little off script here. Is there any new people? Is this your first, anyone here who is your first time attending a town meeting? Don't be bashful, raise your hand. It's great to see you. Okay, a couple here, great. Thank you very much. Your assignment will be to speak on one article today. No, just kidding. But we encourage everyone to participate. This is your meeting. This is why you're here, to be involved in your local government. So now I'm just going over a few ground rules that we go by to try to keep an orderly meeting. It may sound a little drawn out and mundane, but they're needed. So we go by Robert's Rules of Orders, which are the basic rules of order, except where Vermont law takes precedence. The body cannot change state law, but you can change Robert's rules. So an article must be moved and seconded by the body, then restated by the moderator before it's under consideration, and debate on an article may begin. So after I restate the motion, the person who made the motion has the right to speak first. Articles may only have one amendment at a time associated with them, and amendments made to an article likewise may have only one amendment associated with them. So we don't get too far out. And after you've spoken once on a particular article, you will not be recognized a second time during discussion on that article or amendment until all voters who wish to speak on the issue for the first time are given an opportunity. So Robert Rules does allow you to speak twice on a given motion, but no more than twice, and limits the duration of the speeches for no more than 10 minutes. A division of the House can be requested by one voter before or after a voice vote. So Vermont state law provides for a paper ballot vote on the request of 7 voters, unless the town has made other arrangements, which we can and we have not done. But at this point, it's a request of 7 voters before or after a voice vote. Right off the bat, you can ask for a request of a paper ballot or after a division of the House. So all motions, remarks, and discussion must be addressed to the moderator. And I'll do my best to recognize you in the order that you have raised your hands. You must be recognized to speak, even to move the previous question, which means to reconsider the previous question that you just voted on. So after being recognized, stand up, or you can just come to the microphone in order and give your name. We need to have your name. You may be a longtime resident, but there are new folks here, obviously. We need to know who is speaking, who's making the motion, and who's providing the second. So I'll be asking for that. Come to the microphone and speak in a loud voice. Speak fairly close to the microphone. Last night we had a few little sound issues with people standing back too far. Seth has also turned off had the custodians turn off the fan back there, and that I can already tell is helping immensely. Okay, so your speeches must be confined to the merits of the question. You will not be allowed to engage in personal attacks on a member of the body or their motives. We're going to keep it civil here. Vermont state law prohibits consideration of the articles that have not been warned. This means you cannot take binding action under the article other business, and you can't amend warned articles such that they would deal with business that hasn't been warned or change them so significantly that they would be significantly different than what was warned. So reconsideration of an article is allowed by Vermont state law until a point is reached where the body has begun to work on another article. Basically, what this is saying is if we voted on something, and you being a person who voted on the prevailing side, have second thoughts, and you want to request that we revisit that article, you may do so, but you have to be a voter on the prevailing side to do that. So my role as moderator is to help you accomplish the business you intend to do. Raise your hand, ask questions if you don't understand what's happening, or if you think what is happening is wrong for some reason, or if you want to do something but you don't know how to proceed. And please tell me if you feel I'm ruling improperly. You have the right to challenge the moderator's rulings. I will be offended. This is part of the process. It's done in many, many meetings over the years. It's happened. And it's to emphasize that this is your meeting. I might advise that state law doesn't allow what you're trying to do. You can do it, and then we'll deal with the consequences later. Worst thing, it would be a court issue that would be thrown out. I mentioned before that only registered voters may vote or speak at the meeting today unless we make an exception. And I just want to go back to the reconsideration article. We can reconsider an article up until the point that the next article has been presented on the floor. And after that point, we cannot reconsider. Okay. Yes, Carl.
Can you explain what division of the House means, please?
Sure. Yeah, thanks. Division of the House would be if I call for a voice vote and the hands go up and maybe it's somewhat close and I call it one way, and you'll always hear me say, it appears that the ayes or nays have it, and I'll hesitate. And if someone thinks that that's not correct, you can say you request a division of the House or a standing vote. So then we'll go and I'll call for folks to stand. Usually if it's that close though, my recommendation is you go right to a ballot, and then there's no question. But division of the House is beyond the voice vote, is either doing a standing vote or going to a ballot. Thanks, Carl. Okay, now, our next little part of the meeting, as you historically, those who've been here before us, our House representative is always here diligently to bring us up to speed briefly on what's going on in Montpelier. Edie? We'll do that. Yep, thank you. Thank you for reminding me to do that. Sandy Haas, as you know, has been our state representative for many years. And this is going to be her swan song, I guess, for speaking with us tonight, today. So we thank you, Sandy, for all you've done over the years. And if there's no objection, obviously Sandy's not a voter in this town, we'll allow her to speak. If anyone objects, we'll vote. But no, okay, Sandy, the podium's yours.
Good morning. So, as usual, when I come this time of year, we are at almost the midpoint of the legislative session. We go from January into mid-May, and this is the second year of biennium, which means that we can be working on bills that were introduced a year ago, but we have to get finished. Whatever we're going to do, we have to finish with before we adjourn in May, or those issues are dead. And what the immediate deadline is that we have what we call a crossover deadline between the House and Senate. And so by the end of next week, we are in recess this week for town meeting, but when we go back next week, we have four legislative days to get bills out of committee on each side. So a bill that's in the House has to be passed out of committee there, or in the same on the Senate side. Anything that doesn't come out of committee by the end, by the close of business next Friday, will be finished for this year and finished for the biennium. So there are a lot of things that are some of the big issues that you've been following maybe in the news in the next week, and a lot of things will fall off the table for another session. The recent big news is that we did, with the Senate, we did override the governor's veto on minimum wage. So that actually is becoming law. What that means is that people who are currently earning minimum wage, which is $10.96, will go up to $11.75 next January 1st, and the following year it will go to $12.55. Thereafter, the law reverts to the existing cost of living increase that's in existing law. Another big thing that we're working on, we have decided this year that it's finally time for the legislature to take decisive action to address climate change. And there are a number of proposals pending. The House just passed the Global Warming Solutions Act, which now will move to the Senate for them to look it over and take it through the process. As passed by the House, what that does is it puts existing goals that the state had for greenhouse gas reductions into statute. They were just visionary, and this would make them law. It also creates a council to try to put together a plan that will bring together all state agencies. Right now, we don't really have an overall state plan. And so the concept of the council is to figure out how we get everybody together at the table, to figure out how we move forward as one. And what they come up with will then go to the Agency of Natural Resources for rulemaking. Anything that is proposed by the council or by the agency will have to, that requires either an appropriation or any kind of increase in fees or taxes or anything like that, would come back to the legislature. That is exclusively legislative business and has to be done by us. I want to, very soon, you will be receiving your notice of the U.S. Census. And I want to make a personal plea for you to please respond. I met with someone from the census last summer who told me that at least one nearby Vermont town was counted in the last census as having 150 people. And when he spoke to the town clerk, she told him, no, there were 350 people in that town. This is a big deal because the numbers of getting a correct count, what they call a full count, for Vermont, affects the money that we get from the federal government. When we do our budget every year at the state level, about over $2 billion of the money that we spend is money that comes from the federal government, and much of that is based on the information that they have from the census. So you will get something in the mail, you can respond by mail, you can respond by phone, you can respond online, but please don't ignore it. Encourage your family and friends to fully cooperate with the census. The final thing I want to talk about this morning is the coronavirus. That's been in the news a lot. The governor has just put together a task force, again, to get all state agencies together and working together to make sure that we have a plan in place. At the moment, we don't have any reported cases in Vermont, but they seem to be, but there's one in Dartmouth, so they're getting closer every day. The Vermont Department of Health, if you go to their website, the very first thing at the top of the page, is a link to the most current information that they have on how you as an individual and your physicians can deal with the disease. And with that, I will say I wish you, one more thing. I do have a written report, and you can find it on the back table. And I wish you a very productive meeting.
Our state senator, Dick McCormick, is also with us today, and I'd like to
say a few words.
Morning. It's so good to be, as you know, I live here in Bethel. One of the things I don't like about being a state senator, I represent 26 towns. And so town meeting day, trying to get to as many towns as I can, has pulled me away from my own town. And I miss you folks. Our town meetings have always been civil. Remember once, about 25 years ago, things got a little hot. And voices were raised, and a few personal accusations were made, and a voice from the back said, "All right, everybody calm down. This isn't royalty, you know." Yes, I like that. rather than repeat what Sandy said, let me just add a little bit on the global warming thing, which is I would hope that if we had to choose between the short-term bottom line and a healthy, useful, and beneficial environment, I would hope we would choose the environment, that we'd be willing to make sacrifices. But I don't think that's necessarily what we have to do. A lot of what we have to do to combat global warming is going to be profitable. I mean, things like getting on renewable energy and insulating better, that's going to create jobs. And the more we get onto renewable sources of energy, the less money we're sending out of state for the energy we now buy and import. But even if we do have to make a sacrifice, we're coming up on the 75th anniversary of the end of World War II. And I've been thinking, what would have happened if in early 1942, right after Pearl Harbor, if the American people had had the sort of casual attitude about the war that many people have about global warming. In other words, you hear people say, well, yeah, global warming's a problem, but, and, you know, it's, I don't want to be inconvenienced, I don't want to spend any money. If people had said, well, you know, I'm all for winning this war, but rationing sugar is just too extreme. I think we maybe wouldn't have done as well as we did as a nation. But again, it's not just about sacrifice. There are actual economic, short-term, financial benefits as well. I serve on the Appropriations Committee and the Health and Welfare Committee. The Appropriations Committee does the budget. We operate on a fiscal year, July 1st to June 30th. So we are now presently developing the budget for fiscal year 2021. And I'm sure I'm not the only person who feels old. I can't believe I'm even looking at 2021, but there it is. We started the session dealing with the Budget Adjustment Act, which is in the middle of the fiscal year, we make changes because no one's a prophet. No one can predict the future. The budget is based on projections, on best, most responsible guesses. And so it then turns out midway through the fiscal year, every year, well, this revenue source wasn't as good as we thought it would be. We got to get some more money. This revenue source was better than we thought it would be. I wonder what we do with that. This project costs more than we thought it would. And so it's just making budget adjustments. People often say, why don't you just get it right the first time? And again, it's because no one can see the future. You make the best case estimate you can. The analogy I would use is like driving down the road. If you're going to drive straight, you don't actually hold the wheel like this. Driving straight involves a little bit of this. And that's the same thing with budget adjustment. Both on the Budget Adjustment Act and the budget this year, neither was particularly troublesome or controversial. Revenues came in more or less as projected and as expected. Things have cost about what we thought. So we made many small adjustments. Similarly, in developing the fiscal year 2021 budget, the governor proposes a budget. It goes to the House first because they're closer to the people. And then it comes to the Senate because we're supposedly the wise ones who will make sure the House doesn't go off the deep end. I got to tell you, in 30 years, I've never seen it actually work like that. I don't think the House is any smarter. I mean, I don't think the Senate is any smarter than the House. But it doesn't hurt to have two separate bodies consider everything. So everything gets considered twice. Not to mention that we're reconsidering the governor. I think we're going to give the governor, we're going to pass more or less with many, many, many changes, but nothing radical, nothing really upsetting. You may have noticed you haven't heard a lot of argument about the budget, which has happened in other years. So we're going to end up probably passing more or less what the House gave us, which will be more or less what the governor recommended, but always changes. I, for one, am advocating for the parent-child centers. I think they do work that no one else really does as well, and I don't think we support them enough. No one has ever complained that a speech I gave was too short. So, but what I will do, I've got several other towns I want to try to get to. Luckily, the Tuesday morning meetings are all in the same part of the county. So I'm going to try, I've already been to Stockbridge, I'm going to try to get to Barnard next. But I will hang around in the hall for a little while if anyone wants to talk to me, rather than just skip out. But you have a town agenda to deal with, and so... And while I'm here, also, I want to say thank you for your support in the last election and all the elections before that. Thank you. And I'll wait out in the hall. Bye.
Also, we do have in Bethel legislative breakfast the last Monday of the month at 7:30 to 9 o'clock down at this Bethel sandwich shop. So. Sandy is usually always there, Dick's usually always there, and most usually have the two other senators with us as well. So if you have more things to talk to them about, that's the place to go. So before we get into our articles of the day, let's just do it. We'll introduce the head table, and we'll introduce themselves here. The microphone right there.
I'm Pam Brown, I'm your town clerk and treasurer.
I'm Therese Kirby, I'm your new town manager.
Lindley Brainerd, select board member.
Chris Jarvis, select board chair.
Paul Valley, select board member.
Hey, Betty, select board member.
Mo Brigham, select board member.
Okay, thanks very much. Also, the audio today is being provided by Seth Stoddard from Back Road Audio Works. He's around somewhere on his little iPad. So if you're talking mostly on the center microphone and it doesn't come up right that second, just keep talking because he has individual mic controls on his iPad, and he'll bring those up as needed. And so it doesn't get a lot of background noise. He turns them down. All right, I think we're finally ready. Let's get to work here. Article 1 is to elect the town moderator for the term of 1 year, and I'll turn the podium over to our town clerk, Pam Brown.
Nominations are open for town moderator.
I nominate Rick Benson.
Rick Benson has been nominated. Are there any other nominations?
That was a second.
I don't need a second. Any other nominations? Hearing none, I say we cast a ballot for Rick Benson as your moderator. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Rick Benson is your moderator.
Thank you. Article 2, to elect a town clerk for the term of 1 year. Floor is open for nominations.
I nominate Pam Brown.
Okay. Louise Burt is making that nomination. Further nominations for the position of town clerk. Any further nominations? Seeing none, all those in favor of Pam Brown as town clerk for the ensuing year say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? You've elected Pam Brown. Article 3. To elect a town treasurer for the term of 1 year. The floor is open for nominations for town treasurer.
Nomination of Pam Brown.
Okay. Pam Brown is nominated. Further nominations? No, I'm sorry, that was Judy Brigham that made that. Further nominations for town treasurers? Seeing none, all those in favor of electing Pam Brown as your town treasurer, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We've elected Pam Brown. Okay, Article 4, to elect by ballot a select board member for a term of 3 years to succeed Paul Valley, whose term expires. Floor is open for nominations.
Nominate Paul Valley.
State your name, please.
Newt Butkus.
Thank you, Newt.
I second it.
Okay. Technically, we don't need seconds, but that's a good voice of support. Further nominations for the term, the three-year term.
Can you repeat that because it comes up with my...
Paul Valley?
Thank you.
Yep, thank you. Paul Valley's been nominated. Further nominations? Further nominations for the three-year term. If there are none, I entertain a motion to direct the nominations cease and the clerk be directed to cast one ballot in the name of Paul Valley. I entertain that motion. It needs to be moved.
So moved, Gene Krause.
Thank you, Gene. Is there a second on that? Newt Wickham seconds. Very good. All those in favor of electing Paul Valley for the three-year term for select board, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, say no.
It was okay.
Very good. We've elected Paul. Paul, you had mentioned you wanted to say something. And now that you've been elected, I'm sure you still have something to say. Sorry about that.
I spent a lot of time writing this speech. So anyway, underwear. They're all in their underwear. Okay. So good morning. Thank you for coming today and participating in the process. I wanted to give you just a little bit of an insight into the life of a select board member. When I first got onto the select board, I had a mission. My vision was to change everything that was going on at the town office. I didn't like the communication, I didn't like the way the finances were, I didn't like any of that stuff. And I was going to change all that. I was going to march right in there and make everything better. Didn't take long before I figured out that that's not how it works at all. I was given the book. And the book tells you everything you ever wanted to know about being on the select board. And I was told that it was going to take at least a year before I knew anything of what was going on and how the process worked. So shortly after that, we started the search for a new town manager. It was a long process, but a very informative and learning process. We thought Greg was the one. And unfortunately, he wasn't able to complete his term, but one of the best things that ever happened was that he hired Therese. And although I don't know if we found her or she found us, I'm not quite sure, but we're real glad that we did. The primary duty of select board members is to oversee the overall operations of the town and to protect the interests of the taxpayers. This involves a lot of reading, getting familiar with state statutes, local ordinances, and policies. Also, we have to study each line of the budget to be sure we're operating as efficiently as we can in spending our money. It's all our money. If you come to a select board meeting or you view us on Orca, we address a multitude of topics as simple as coin drops or as complicated as a $2.8 million water line replacement project and everything in between. I also serve as the chair of the Board of Civil Authorities, and we deal with all the election material that happens, as well as tax assessment appeals and abatements. I also sit on the Human Services Advisory Board, and we'll talk more about that, those folks later. Recently, I got involved with Two Rivers Ottauquechee Regional Planning Commission as Bethel's representative. This is a regional organization of 31 towns that meet to oversee town plans and proper land development policy. I also review the payroll and payables each week as the Select Board representative. Why be on the Select Board? It's certainly not for the money. It figures out to be less than a dollar an hour, if you do the math. It's not for the recognition. I'm on the board not to give back to my community, but just to be part of my community. I love being approached on the street and asked a question or told an opinion, and I try to answer as best I can. Don't promise anything I can't deliver. And if I don't know the answer, find out and get back to the folks and let them know what's happening. I feel very fortunate to work with the other four members and Therese, of course. We all have diverse backgrounds and various areas of expertise. We don't always agree, but we always discuss the topics and find a consensus and make decisions that we feel are the best for the town. So I want to thank you for your support over the last few years, and I hope, you did return me to the board for another term. Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Okay, on to Article 5. To elect by ballot a Select Board member for a term of 2 years to succeed Lindley Brainerd, whose term expires. And yes, it is 2 years. It was printed wrong in the report.
So, don't we have to make a motion from the floor to correct that warning?
We can do that if you'd like.
I mean, legally.
It was, the legal posting was correct. Okay, what was in the paper was correct. So what's in the report is not technically, because I promised you, see, it wasn't signed. So if you feel strongly about it, we can certainly do that. But not entertain a motion to do that if you wish. But if not, understand this is a 2-year term. And again, floor is open for nominations. Okay, that's what you were going to say. Okay, Mary Floyd. Is there a second? Oh, I'm sorry, we don't need a second on the nomination. Further nominations for Lindley. Further nominations for the 2-year term. Maybe I should have another cup of coffee. Further nominations for the 2-year term. Before I call for the motion to end nominations, I'm going to have Lindley speak this time before, because I know she's prepared something too.
Good morning, and thank you all for coming today. It's been an honor to serve this town for the last 2 years, and over this time I've focused on getting to know more residents, listening to the thoughts and concerns of individuals, and learning more of the history and the wide variety of perspectives that make our town so unique. We've had some major ups and downs over the last year, and I'm proud to be on a board that has handled major weather events and the unforeseen transition of a town manager with such poise and focus. Everyone on this board brings a different perspective and different strengths. I believe together we are able to work to benefit the town, and of course we would be lost without the town offices and town crew that do the real heavy lifting on a daily basis. Personally, I've continued to work with the community on a number of fronts through the Bethel Revitalization Initiative, Downtown Businesses, Conservation Commission, Energy Commission, and Rec Departments, and many more. I've also been attending trainings and statewide conferences focused on the larger issues facing our state. I hope to bring what I've learned to aid in our town's decision-making process as these issues arise. If reelected, I plan to work with Therese and the downtown businesses and businesses throughout Bethel to improve our economic vitality as a town. As most of you know, I co-own and operate a downtown business, the Arnold Block, which is part of a larger effort working to keep our downtown sector thriving. None of our businesses would survive without the constant support of everyone in this town, despite road work, traffic hangups, economic downturns. This summer will hold a similar story to last summer as we continue to support each other and keep our downtown businesses alive through the water main repairs. I'm proud to now work for the Bethel school system, getting the opportunity to know more of our future generation of Bethel residents, some of whom I've seen here today. We have a really fantastic group of kids and young adults who I believe will make our town and the world an even better place. I've learned so much over the past few years and feel ready to embark on another term to generate even more positive movement for our town as we move into a new decade. I would be honored to continue to serve this town and all of you to the best of my abilities.
Further nominations for the two-year term of Select Board member? Seeing none, I entertain a motion that nominations cease and that one ballot be cast in the name of Lindley Brainerd.
So moved, Gene Krause.
Thank you. Is there a second for that motion?
I second.
Okay. We have a motion and a second to end nominations and that the clerk be instructed to cast one ballot in the name of Lindley Brainerd for the two-year term of Select Board member. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? You've elected Lindley Brainerd. Article 6, to elect by ballot a lister for a term of 3 years to succeed Louise Ferris Burke, whose term expires. And I believe Louise would like to speak before we open nominations.
I'm sure I need this down. Someone else can move it up. I'm not running for the 3 year term. I'm going to be running for the 1 year. This will be my last year. I'm nominating Judith Brigham for the 3 year term. The Lister's office has been a little bit in turmoil due to health reasons and people having other avenues of work. So I do want to thank Jim Gray, who's been my right-hand person for many years, Roberta Carrier, Bev Washburn, and a lot of other local people who've stepped up to be listers over the years. The Lister's office needs people who are willing to learn a very difficult job, who have a background that brings something to the table. Over the years, we've had people who had real estate backgrounds, banking, insurance, and construction. Any one of those brings something that really helps our office. We do have three people willing to run for our three positions at this time, but we do need to keep thinking forward. We do have one staff person, Penny Griffin, who does one component of our job for us to help alleviate some of the time constraints. So I thank you and wanted to reiterate that Judith Brigham is nominated for the 3 year term.
Okay, Louise, let me just formally open the floor for nominations and I will take your nomination for Judith Brigham. Further nominations for that 3 year term to succeed Louise in that particular position. Any further nominations? I'd entertain that motion then that we that nominations cease and that we instruct the clerk to deposit one ballot in the name of Judith Brigham for the 3 year term of Lister. Do I hear a nomination motion? Thank you, Louise. Is there a second? Okay, Mr. Russ. Very good. The motion's been made and seconded that we have nominations and that the clerk be instructed to deposit a ballot in the name of Judith Brigham for the 3 year term of Lister. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We've elected Judy Brigham. Article 7, to elect by ballot a Lister for the term of 1 year to succeed Jim Gray, who resigned and whose term expires in 2021. The floor is open for nominations. Okay, Judy Brigham is nominating Louise Ferris Burt. Further nominations for the 1 year remaining of the term of Jim Grace. Further nominations. Seeing none, I'd entertain a motion that nomination ceased and the clerk be instructed to cast one ballot in the name of Louise Ferris Burt for the 1 year term. See someone moving that. Thank you, Carl. All right. Is there a second? Do I see a second on that? Okay. We've got. Yeah. nominations and to elect Louise Burt for the one-year term to succeed Jim Gray. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We've elected Louise Burt for the one-year term. Article 8, to elect by ballot a lister for a term of 2 years to succeed Roberta Carrier, who resigned and whose term expires in 2022. Floor is open for nominations.
I nominate Brad Morrill Cornelius. It's hyphenated. He brings to the table the fact that he had worked with the Royalton listers, and we're very excited that he's willing to step forward.
And the last name is Morrill?
Morrill.
Yep. Okay, got it, thanks. Further nominations for the 2 year remaining term for Lister. Further nominations, seeing none, I entertain that motion. There'll be cease nominations and the clerk be instructed to cast one ballot in the name of Brad Morrill Cornelius for the 2 year term. All those, was that moved? Second on the motion, please. Louise, thank you. So the motion's been made and seconded that we cease nominations, that the clerk be instructed to cast the ballot for Brad Morrill Cornelius for the 2 year term to succeed Roberta Carrier as Lister. All those say, in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. And we've elected Brad Cornelius, Morrill Cornelius. Article 8, to elect one or more grand juror. This is not a ballot item, can be done from the floor. Nominations are open for grand juror.
Who's serving in the capacity now?
Stan Capron is currently serving in that capacity. Did I see him?
Stan Capron.
And name?
Sheldon Bush.
Thank you, Sheldon. Stan Capron's been nominated. Further nominations for the position of grand juror. Stan says it was kind of grueling this year, but he'd be willing to take it again. Further nominations? Seeing none, all those in favor of Stan Capron serving as grand juror say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We've elected Stan Capron. Article 10, to elect a town agent. Jason Rogers served in this position the first time last year. Nominations, the floor is open for nominations for town agent. Kelly. Okay, Jason Rogers been nominated by Kelly Hill. Do we have further nominations? Further nominations for town agent? Seeing none, all those in favor of Jason Rogers being elected as town agent say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We've elected Jason Rogers. Article 11, to elect a trustee of public funds under Section 24 BSA for a term of 3 years to succeed Carol Ketchum, whose term expires. Floor is open for nominations.
I nominate Carol Ketchum.
Okay, Louise, thank you. Louise has nominated Carol Ketchum. Do we have further nominations for trustee of public funds? Seeing none, all in favor of electing Carol Ketchum to a 3 year term as trustee of public funds, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We've elected Carol Ketchum. Article 12. I'll read the article and then we'll have a short presentation by the board on this one. Article 12. Shall the voters authorize total fund expenditures for operating expenses of $2,494,432, of which $2,058,149 shall be raised by taxes, and $426,283 non-tax revenues. I'm going to amend what I just said here. Let's move the motion and have a second so it's in discussion stage and then I'll recognize the board. So if anyone would move that motion so we can move to discussion.
Yep.
Bob Dean has moved it. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. So Bob Dean has moved motions. Flavikos Stanchuk has seconded. All those in favor I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm getting ahead of myself. So, I'm going to state the motion one more time, and we'll put it on the floor. Shall the voters authorize total fund expenditures for operating expenses of $2,494,432, of which $2,058,149 shall be raised by taxes, and $426,283 non-tax revenues. So I will recognize Chris Jarvis now from the Select Board. And then Bob, if you wish to speak as maker of the motion right after, you can.
All right, thank you. First off, I just wanted to apologize. We had, for whatever reason this year, between the draft town meeting day proposals and budget versus what went to print, some things got lost in translation between the two of them. So as you saw, there was an unsigned warning in our book, as well as there was a couple other mistakes that were corrected when we did the final version that didn't get to the printer. So I just wanted to apologize for that. So just first, before getting right into the numbers of the budget, as we've said the last couple of years, the goal for our administration and the Select Board is first and foremost to be transparent, build realistic budgets based on the services needed to the community, execute the budget sufficiently, and just be responsive to the community and its needs. A couple of futuristic plannings that are going on currently we're continuing to develop or revise policies. And by doing developments and revisions of policies, it does make the government more efficient. The Water Master Plan and the positive bond vote that was in November, and we'll be seeing the first stage of that this summer. The working on the future public works facility that's greatly needed and well overdue. And then vast amounts of other infrastructure type planning. Quick little review of the past year. Every year has its own challenges. This year we did, ran out of the gate. Mother Nature, while everything was thawing, decided that she was going to drop 5 or 6 inches of rain on us, which made our roads in dire need of repair. That ended up needing FEMA or federal highway assistance. So while that was going on, the current town manager that we had at the time had to step down. And for a brief period, we were in limbo with the town manager, but Therese was able to fill that capacity very well. And I don't felt that we really missed any beat there. Throughout the year, there's been the Water Master Plan that has been, all the different revisions and then to the vote in November. The fire station was able to take advantage of the grant for self-contained breathing apparatuses, which, ended up saving the town of Bethel a little over $100,000. We did end up having a constable this year. And then we've also proposed a draft garbage ordinance. So those are kind of some of the bigger ticket items in review for the year. Getting into the budget, I'll go through the revenues first because those usually end up being the easier part of the budget. Overall, the revenues are up $39,000 versus last year. A majority of that is made up of delinquent tax collecting, penalties and fees that are associated with taxes. A small little bit in regards to rec fees that are up at the pool. The cost end of things, public works wise, which usually is the bigger ticket item because it's the largest part of our budget. We did have a retirement in the public works this past year. It was decided that instead of rehiring full-time for that person, that we've decided to do a seasonal hire for the winters So instead of being a one person replacing it down with a half, with an individual that that will work in the winter time, the savings there to the town again is a half person for the year, as well as any of the very costly insurance and benefits. You will see, because of that, during the spring, summer, and fall, you know, being that we will be down one person, that we decided to hire out some of the services that we had been doing. We've also decided to start or increase, as we found out this past spring with the flood events, that, you know, there are a lot of our roads that, that need more attention that we're currently not giving them. So within this budget, we have some increased funding for adding gravel to roads, ditching policies, and others. I also see in the budget that we're going to be a little more efficient with our sand and salt usage in the winter time. And I think everybody that's seen the roads this winter, that they're in just as good condition as they were last year. Just we're saving the taxpayers some money on making sure that things are calibrated and executed correctly. Even though it really doesn't have much to do with public works, it's in the line item, the ERAF money, which is the percentage that the town is responsible for the FEMA reimbursement, which is about 12.5% of all FEMA work, was a big ticket item of $118,000. So that is our portion of what we have to pay back in result of the spring floods. And also under the public works, some upgrades to the Fairview fence and Cherry Hill Cemetery wall. Over to municipal office. Municipal office was kind of about the same as look as the public works, where you know, we are doing things more efficiently with basically one less person in the office. But the duties have been spread out to two other current employees. Again, the benefits to that is we don't have to pay for another full-time person, as well as all the paying for insurance and benefits. Listers, you'll see that there's an increase this year on the listers percentage, which is higher than normal. The thinking at the budget time was, at that time, it was a question mark in regards to who would be running for listers services, which at that time, currently, I think we had one person when we drafted the budget. And the challenge there is, you know, the listers office needs to be not only full with all its members, but has to be working efficiently and have the knowledge base to make sure that our grant list is updated and constantly evolving. We did put some money into the budget in case we needed an outside service to provide some of those services. And even though that we do have three individuals that have been nominated today, remember, it's just like any other office, it takes time to get new people in and trained and up to speed, as well as, you know, someone taking on a new role, you never know if they're gonna last out their whole term. So there's some money in there today just in case we need some outside services for that. Capital funding plan, we increased slightly on that, $5,000, which basically is gonna start doing some exploratory engineering for possible public works building sites. So at this point, we're poking around in our own footprint up there where we're at currently to see what can we build there. That will definitely be something that we'll be looking at board-wise this year. Overall revenues are up $39,000. The costs overall are up $94,544. The net increase is $55,544, which is 2.8 cents once you figure in the grant list. So at the same time, you know, I'm only showing a net increase of $55,000 for this year, which is 2.5 cents. We also have to take into consideration that we're retiring our ERAP debt from all the spring flooding, which that itself is 6 cents. So I guess if you looked at, if we didn't have the spring flood, you know, the budget in some ways, comparing apples to apples, is a minus 3 cent budget. The board decided that we wanted to be responsible in retiring our deficit or our debt to the ERAF. There are a couple of different options that we could have done. Could have obviously taken out a loan and paid interest on a loan, but we decided based upon how our budget was looking with some of the efficiencies that that we're starting to see with the town, that it was most responsible for us to just retire that money this year. We also have a little bit more FEMA projects that didn't get finished this year that will be finished next year. So we will have some additional ERAP financial responsibilities for next year. So that was kind of our reasoning for retiring that debt in this budget. So that's all I had, unless anybody has any questions.
Thank you for that, Gene Cross. Thanks for that explanation and review of the budget. Can you tell me what, if anything, is in there that addresses, from the town's expenditures perspective, the climate emergency, i.e. savings in energy use in our public buildings, and electric vehicles, any of those kinds of things that may be in the budget that has not been named, and or what, if any, consideration is being given to those kinds of expenditures that in the long run we're going to have to pay. And so that's my question. What's in there?
Okay. Anyone from the board care to tackle that one?
Should be on, Chris. Just go ahead and start talking.
All right. So just to respond back to that, without having to look through every line item, overall-wise, the two things that stick out right out of the gate is we do participate with Green Lantern and a solar array facility. The second, probably the most money that's put in the budget in regards to some of the climate concerns is into our roads and our infrastructure that we've seen with the larger storm events that we've been seeing over the last, you know, decades. So we're not only we're trying to build our roads back to where they were, but to try to also improve upon those roads. And I spoke to it just very briefly on upgrading things like eroding gravel roads, ditch lines. As long as I've been here, the 14 years, I don't think we've ever had a line item for ditching. So just trying to improve stormwater runoff would be probably the biggest things. We also do have the Energy Committee, which brings ideas to the Select Board often. And one that they had been working on was a electrical chargeable vehicle station that they had spent actually quite a bit of time preparing. And as a board, we had moved forward with the funds to match it, grant. But then to turn around, the Agency of Transportation decided to put, there's a new parking ride that's going to be built down by the interstate, and they're going to have like 22 charging stations there. So we ended up taking that out of ours, because just at this point, having one charging station in Bethel versus 22 down the road, at that point it seemed to make a lot of sense. But I would say that any questions that are directed in regards to climate change, definitely we have a very positive, vibrant energy committee that meets here in town. They're always looking for new ideas, and they come and they haven't spoken to us in a few months, but they usually check in about once a quarter to see what's on their plate.
Further questions on Article 12? Now is the time to ask. And if you're curious about anything, if maybe you're reading something that doesn't necessarily make sense to you, please come forward and ask the question.
I just want to comment that I think in the future we need to build something in on a capital basis for the town offices. Having worked in that building for 20 years, it's very out of date. And going forward, we need to address the fact that parking is an issue and the building is getting very old.
Thank you, Louise. Any further comment or questions on Article 12? George, if you'd like.
Yeah, I can just quickly respond back to Louise's comment in regards to the town office. So right now we've kind of prioritized that the Public Works building is most in need at this point for our services. Not to say that the town office isn't. But as a priority, the next one we'll be working on would be the Public Works office. We have established some funds to make our current town office more energy efficient and be able to repair some issues that we have there so that we can hopefully stay there for another half a dozen or so years while we get through the first building a Public Works building, and then look for a possible new municipal site. And I think we definitely all understand that the parking and location of the office is a very challenging one. I get beat that all the time when I want to, stop and back into a parking spot. So we are working on it. It is definitely out there for us, and we have been talking about that. So,
further questions?
Julie Krauss. I don't know if this is the appropriate place or not, so correct me if I'm wrong. First, I'd like to compliment the highway people, because the roads have been in better condition over on Findlay Bridge than they've been in a long time. Doesn't mean they're good yet, but they've been so much better. My question is around the bridge at Store Hill Road and Factory Hill Road. And I think it's a state. I don't know who's responsible for it. That's the first question. And the second, is it in the vision for the future to have it replaced or the top surface replaced? It's in horrible shape.
You're talking East Bethel, correct?
Yes.
If there's no objection, also, I forgot to mention this earlier, our town manager, Therese Kirby, is a Brookfield resident, and if there's no objection, we'll allow her to speak today. Go for it.
Just making sure. So, yes, there is money in the budget this year. We put $35,000 into the highway capital expense capital fund to deal with that, and your bridge is actually going to be receive some work this summer. We do have gone over all of the bridge inspection reports. Unfortunately, there's several bridges in Bethel that need work. So my hope is to allocate the $35,000 to different bridges this summer. I'm well aware yours needs to have a cable rail upgrade, also needs to have a new jacking port, because I know I can see the rebar in it right now. And so yes, actually you are on the list and we will address it this summer. So thank you for bringing that up.
Okay. Further questions? We'll just form a line here, that's good.
Todd Sears, question for...
Put the mic up.
Oh, sorry. Better angle. On ERAF. So I do know that, so we're a 12.5% town, and you're probably aware that there is the option to boost that up to a 17.5 if we get involved with the FEMA community rating standard. And it was just a suggestion that, we have the RBC Two Rivers is, fairly very competent and could help us take a look at that. It's another way to gain 5% from the state if this were to happen again, and it will happen again. So just a suggestion to take a look at that and maybe address it next year or whatever.
Thanks, Todd. Carl?
Carl Russell. And I'll just follow that up with, we had a great opportunity to implement development restrictions on our river corridors, and we would have conformed to what Todd was just talking about, but so that would be something that the new town plan might have to be looking at again. I'm just going to make a suggestion that as you're contemplating a new municipal garage, might be a great opportunity to include the design for municipal offices in that building.
Thank you, Carl. Further discussion, further questions on Article 12? We've had some good questions and comments so far. Is that it for questions? Are we ready to call for questions? Very good. I see no hands, no one jumping up. I'll read the article one more time. Article 12. Shall the voters authorize total fund expenditures for operating expenses of $2,494,432, of which $2,058,149 shall be raised by taxes and $426,283 non-tax revenues. All those in favor of Article 12 respond by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say no. The ayes appear to have it, and do have it. Article 12 passes. Okay, Article 13, one of those gremlins in the printing, was leaving out Article, most of Article 13. As I mentioned, there are replacement articles in the back of the slip of paper. And again, the bulk of this article was printed in the paper and posted with everything in there. I'm going to read the article, and we'll have some work to do on it. So Article 13 states, shall the voters appropriate a total of $27,115 to the following social service agencies pursuant to 24 BSA 2691. And the agencies are Clara Martin Center, $3,000, One Planet, $2,500, Quintown Senior Center, $1,200, South Royalton Senior Center, $3,000, Vermont Association for the Blind, $800, Vermont Center for Independent Living, $300, Healthcare and Rehab Services, $250, that bled over into the report. Vermont Adult Learning, $200, Health Hub, $1,000, Orange County Parent Child Center, $1,000, Safeline, $1,000, Stagecoach, $4,000, Visiting Nurses Association, $6,000, Windsor County Partners, $600, Central Vermont Council on Aging, $650, American Red Cross, $250. So to start, I entertain a motion to approve this, and we'll need a second, and then we'll go into discussion and further action. So, okay, Carl, let's move. Do we have a second? Okay, we have a second from Davis. Let me just briefly read this again. Article 13, shall the voters appropriate a total of $27,115 to the following social service agencies pursuant to 24 BSA 2691. And I'll read those amounts that I just read again before we vote. And before going any further, I'll turn this over to Paul for some explanations. Underwear.
So the Human Services Advisory Board meets in the first week of December, and we've been a pretty steady committee. Sandy Farrell is on the committee, Stan Capron, and myself, and Paul Feeney has not been as active, but is on the committee, and our fearless leader, Carol Ketchum. And each year we get together and we look at the requested amounts from area nonprofits. It's been customary over the years that the town of Bethel helped contribute to these nonprofits, especially the ones that help directly impact Bethel residents. So we ask them to submit to us a letter of the outlining what their request is, some financial statements, and also how their organization impacts the Bethel residents directly. So this year we got together, and you can, if you look on page 63 of your town report, you'll see a breakdown of the names of the groups, what they requested, and what we're proposing be the allocations for this year. I understand that the total down in the bottom column, bottom right-hand column, should read $25,750 instead of $700. So overall, it's about an increase of $1,100. I also need to mention that we had a situation this year that I want to bring out. If you look at 2019, the Central Vermont Council of the Aging, without getting into all the details, their appropriation was not passed through to the committee, so it did not get put forward onto last year's request. About 6 weeks ago or so, they contacted the town and brought this to our attention. And so we informed them, they came to the select board, we talked about a select board meeting, we asked them to send somebody to the town meeting here to possibly get up and talk about this appropriation, because they were in need of the appropriation. And had the material gotten to us, they would have been approved for the appropriation. They've been a regular contributor. A regular part of the organization, nonprofit organizations that we don't need to. So I just want to bring that to everybody's attention. Any questions? Do we have any questions about the... Yep, go ahead.
Just some clarification, because page 63 has a different proposed amount from what we just opened up, $27,115 versus $25,700. So which is the amount we'll actually be voting on?
You'll actually be needing a motion to amend to the $27,750.
$25,750.
$25,750. So you'll need to move forward with a motion to amend the article.
So to amend down from the $27,750.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I make that motion to amend to $25,700. The Human Service Advisory Committee.
$25,750. Yes, it was wrong both places.
Okay. Okay, $25,750. As a past member of this committee, it's a lot of work, a lot of reading, and I commend the committee for their hard work.
Okay. Okay, we have an amendment on the floor to amend the total from $27,115, and actually it's a correction, to $25,750. Do we have a second for that amendment? Yep. Okay. Do we have any further? Yep. Is there a discussion on the amendment? We'll go back to the main article after. Any discussion on changing that amount? Okay, motion's been made and seconded to amend Article 13 to read, shall the voters appropriate a total of $25,750 to the following social service agencies. All those in favor of the amendment say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Very good. We go back to the main article. And Carol, would you like to speak regarding that?
Yeah, Carl Russell. I'd like to speak to the issue of the Central Vermont Council on Aging, the fact that they've been a substantially valuable organization to the town of Bethel for many years, and they contacted me and asked me if I would consider bringing the issue to the floor of, about their missed appropriations for last year. So at this point in time, I'd like to offer an additional amendment to increase the current allocation to incorporate an additional $650, which is what their 2019 allocation or proposed allocation would have been, to get them back up to their normal contribution, because they have been actually providing their normal services to the residents throughout the year without that additional funding. So that would be make an amendment to change the funding to $26,350 or $400. $26,400.
Okay. All right. Carl has made the motion to amend Article 13 to change the amount from $25,750 now to $26,400. Do I have a second for that proposed amendment?
Seconded.
Who was that?
Seconded.
And your name?
Karen Bixler.
Very good. Further discussion on the amendment to increase the Central Vermont Council on the Aging an additional $650, which would bring us to $26,400. Any further discussion on that amendment? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, the amendment has passed. Now we're back again to Article 13. Is there any further discussion on, and is there anyone here from these agencies who would like to speak regarding their requests? We do open the floor up to that if there's anyone around here. Okay. Just tip that microphone down a bit.
Hi, I'm from Claire Martin Center, and I just want to say
that. And your name?
Rachel Yeager.
Thank you, Rachel.
And I just want to say how much we greatly appreciate the contribution that you give to us. We utilize it really well, and
come a little closer to the mic.
And we just offer mental health and substance abuse to everyone who needs it, and this makes a big impact. We've done it the last few years, and I just want to say that we really appreciate what the contribution the town makes to Claire Martin Center.
Thank you. Anyone else here from any of the agencies? Yeah. And you're a visitor, right? Yeah. All right.
Yes, Mike Rader from Stagecoach. I'd also like to express our thanks for your long-term support of our organization. And just let you know that in the last fiscal year, FY19, Stagecoach provided over 112,000 rides across Orange and Northern Windsor counties, including 5,993 rides to residents in the town of Bethel or people that have boarded our buses at Bethel stops. This includes 12 bus routes that serve commuters to the West Lebanon area, as well as local services to Gifford Hospital, Giffordville Daycare, a number of services around, including senior meal programs in Hancock, Royalton, and Woodstock. We also do a dial-a-ride program for seniors and people with disabilities that need access to medical appointments and food shopping. That will provide door-to-door service to eligible people there. And a little plug, we always need volunteer drivers for that program. So if anyone's interested in volunteering some time, we do provide reimbursement for miles driven. And we'd love to have your help out there, too.
All right, thank you very much. Anyone else from any of the agencies listed? Okay, seeing none, I'll read through the article one final time. Article 13, shall the voters appropriate a total of $26,400 to the following social service agencies pursuant to 24 VSA 2691. And again, those agencies are Claire Martin Center, $3,000, One Planet, $2,500, Quintown Senior Center, $1,200, South Royalton Senior Center, $3,000. Vermont Association for the Blind, $800. Vermont Center for Independent Living, $300. Healthcare and Rehabilitative Services, $250. Vermont Adult Learning, $200. Health Hub, $1,000. Orange County Parent and Child Center, $1,000. Safeline, $1,000. Stagecoach, $4,000. Visiting Nurses Association, $6,000. Windsor County Partner, $600. And now Central Vermont Aging. Vermont Council on Aging is $1,300 this year. And American Red Cross, $250. All those in favor of Article 13, respond by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. The ayes appear to have it. And do have it. Article 13 passes as amended. Article 14, shall voters appropriate up to the sum of $123,900 to the White River Valley Ambulance Incorporated for continued service to Bethel residents. We need a motion and a second to move the article. Do I hear everyone moving the article?
So moved.
Okay, raise your hand. Okay. Is there a second?
I second.
Okay, Ellie, thank you. Again, Article 14, shall the voters appropriate up to the sum of $123,900 to the White River Valley Ambulance Incorporated for continued services to Bethel residents. Do we have someone from the ambulance service here today? I think there is in the town report, a report from them. So if there's no further comment, then I'll call the question. Let me throw it one more time. Article 14, shall the voters appropriate up to the sum of $123,900 to the White River Valley Ambulance Incorporated for continued service to Bethel residents? All those in favor of Article 14 respond by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed. Article 14 passes. Article 15, shall voters renew the exemption of the Middle Branch Grange number 46 for its property located at 78 Story Hill Road in East Bethel from the real estate taxes for a period of 5 years pursuant to 32 VSA 3840. We'll need a motion and a second to move the article to discussion. Do I hear a motion to approve? Gene? Thank you, Gene. Do we have a second? Okay, thank you. I'll read the article one more time. It's been moved and seconded. Article 15, shall the voters renew the exemption of the Middle Branch Grange number 46 for its property located at 78 Story Hill Road in East Bethel from real estate taxes for a period of 5 years pursuant to 32 VSA 3840. I believe we have someone to speak regarding that.
Yes, Derek Wright. This article has been coming for the townspeople every 5 years for the past 20 years or more. The article asks for a 5-year extension of the tax exempt status granted by the townspeople 5 years ago. The Grange Hall is used by agricultural organizations for their meetings, individuals, for wedding receptions, birthday, and anniversary parties. The local 4-H group uses the hall for their meetings. It makes a good place for community meetings on that side of the town. The Grange really appreciates the support the town has given it in the past and hopes for a continuation of that support. And just for everyone's information, at last year's tax rate, the taxes on the building would have been $2,900.
Okay, Rick, thank you for that.
Thank you.
Further discussion on Article 15. Are we ready to call the question? Very good. I'll read again once more. Shall the voters, Article 15, shall the voters renew the exemption of the Middle Branch Grange number 46 for its property located at 78 Story Hill Road in East Bethel from the real estate taxes for a period of 5 years, pursuant to 32 VSA 3840. All those in favor of Article 15, respond by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Article 15 passes. Article 16, shall the voters authorize payment of real personal property taxes in four equal installments, with due dates being August 15th, 2020, November 15th, 2020, February 15th, 2021, and May 15th, 2021, by delivery to the town office postmarked on or before that date. Do I hear a motion? We'll need a motion and a second. Anyone willing to move this forward? We can discuss it.
I'll move.
Okay, Carl, do we have a second, Gene? All right. Motion's been made and seconded for Article 16. Shall the voters authorize payment of real and personal property taxes in four equal installments, with the due dates being August 15th, 2020, November 15th, 2020, February 15th, 2021, and May 15th, 2021, by delivery to the town office postmarked on or before that date. Questions, discussion? Anybody on this issue? A little bit of housekeeping, I guess. Seeing none, all those in favor of Article 16, which is, shall the voters authorize payment of real and personal property taxes in four equal installments, with due dates being August 15th, 2020, November 15th, 2020, February 15th, 2021, and May 15th, 2021, by delivery to the town office postmarked on or before that date. All in favor of 16, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes appear to have it. Article 16 is passed. Article 17. Before we get into this, I think I'll turn this over to Chris, because we need a little housekeeping on this one too, right? Or Therese.
Just wanted to make a clarification that it was printed that this would be a binding resolution, which it won't be a binding resolution. the voters don't have the power to enact an ordinance like this, that only the select board does. So just clearing up that formality of things. So I've been asked a lot of questions over the last probably about 6 months. We've been working on this ordinance, and the biggest question always is, where did this come from? So just kind of go back, a little story on it. So this past spring, we had the floods and everything else, but we had a large amount of complaints this spring. It wasn't just in regards to one property or two, but there was 10 or 12 or more properties that there were, legitimate complaints about trash and litter, excessive. So what happens when these complaints come into the town office is that, initially the town manager looks at those, or the town health officer gets flooded with these complaints. So what we quickly found out is, one, the town of Bethel doesn't have any authority to regulate trash on somebody's property. And we also found out, and duly elected deputy health director, that the health officer doesn't have any authority to do anything when it comes to trash on somebody's property. Kind of going into it, I thought, as a health officer, why can't you? Isn't it a health issue if there's trash piled up on somebody's house, or if there's a potential of some vermin to spread from one place to the other? You'd think that if common sense would tell you that would be a case, the health officer would have power. But unfortunately, looking through the responsibilities given by the state of Vermont, it's not. So we were flooded with a lot of these instances that we had to go out, spend some time, see what was going on. A lot of cases, no reports were filed because there was nothing that we could do. So the select board ourselves, you know, we were not prepared. You know, we talked about this transparency thing in my speech earlier. And, you know, one thing that we pride ourselves on is being transparent, you know, not pushing our own agendas. So what we started to do is we kind of looked around of, you know, what are other towns or villages or municipalities doing in regards to similar instances. And then the way some of these are affecting us currently is, you know, spring is always the perfect time of year. You know, if there's a lot of trash piled up over the wintertime, it all unthaws and it smells and it attracts all of the wildlife that had been hibernating or, you know, wants a full belly. It also affected the town that we have two tax sale properties. We had a tax sale last year that was, you know, Teresa's done a good job of paying back taxes. We did have two properties that we weren't able to sell at tax sale time, and mainly because of the trash that was piled up at the homes. And then, like I said, the town currently doesn't have any legal authority to regulate any of those nuisance calls that we get, nor does the health officer. So the select board, you know, we decided to, with help from Therese and others in the town office, was to let's look out there to see what other areas are doing. Do they have ordinances? What does it look like? So we, over the last 6 months, have kind of been looking at that, and we started to put together a draft ordinance of what we felt the language should be in there to address the large complaints we were having in the springtime. We did decide as a board that we did not want to enact an ordinance just based upon, you know, the five of us in a meeting with, you know, usually we get, you know, other than Lisa there, we usually have probably, you know, two or three other townspeople. So, you know, it's not really getting a whole wide range of opinions on the matter. So we decided that we would go with a non-binding resolution during town meeting day, and then based upon the results of that, then we would enact as a board on, you know, putting it in as an ordinance or not. We did have a couple of different draft ordinances that we did deal with. You know, initially it was you know, rubbish, trash, litter, solid waste is kind of pretty much all the same material. Once we started looking at some of the other municipalities, there's other things that come into it, like construction waste and, you know, wood, junk cars, mobile homes, you know, things that, you know, haven't moved in a period of time that either are not registered or otherwise. Our first draft that we had, if I remember right, our first draft, it was based off of the Village of Essex, for the most part, draft that they have for an ordinance that did encompass things like automobiles and you know, campers and other, you know, construction waste and things like that. We did have our open hearing. Our hearing was in November. Yeah, but we had some open hearings, and based upon the opinions of some of the individuals that had attended the hearings that we had at Select Board, we made some adjustments with it and took out everything and just went right back down to the initial complaint, which was garbage, trash, litter, and that's kind of where we fine-tuned it for now. I am not going to go through word for word on the ordinance. However, I just wanted to highlight the top part, just kind of read that aloud. Of, for the most part, it you know, encompasses what the ordinance is about. So what this was, it says, whereas the town of Bethel has, by authority granted in 24 BSA, the powers to adopt, amend, repeal, and enforce ordinances, and to manage and regulate outdoor storage of garbage, trash, litter, and solid waste within its boundaries. Now, therefore, to protect the public health, safety, and well-being, and to promote the responsible use of resources and protection of the environment, The Select Board, Town of Bethel, hereby adopts this ordinance to regulate outdoor storage of garbage, trash, litter, and solid waste, but excluding duly authorized junkyards by the state of Vermont. And the state of Vermont has its own ordinance on that. Going through the ordinance here, if you grab the handout or if you had one ahead of time, it does, the first section just states the definitions of what is, you know, what is garbage, what is litter, you know, solid waste. You know, for the most part, it's those materials are all very commonly similar. The section two is basically putting on to the duly owners and occupants of the responsibilities of what you would have on your property for those materials. And then section three, you have to have some sort of enforcement of, you know, if there was a complaint that was then gone and inspected and cleared as a legitimate complaint, then there would be an enforcement piece, which is, you know, we always think of enforcement as, you know, you're going to get a note on your door or the constable's going to show up, but it'd be more of a formality process of a letter that would be sent to the property owner explaining the issue and a time to clear it up or to identify the issues with the town with some sort of schedule on cleaning it up. And then with enforcement, there would be penalties. The penalties section here is pretty common language with other municipalities of the same size. And then just like anything, you know, the owners would have the right to appeal any said violations or penalty. You know, and I know it's, you know, ordinances like this are very tough. You know, everybody's got their own opinion on, you know, what you should or shouldn't have at your house. You know, I have a very strong opinion of, you know, my opinion anyways is, you know, I don't want people to tell me what I have to do on my property, which, you know, which is tough on, you know, an ordinance like this. But, you know, if you look at history, you know, a lot of ordinances are drafted off of the very, very, very small minority of instances rather than the majority of people that are actually, you know, doing what they should be doing responsibly. You know, one challenge with these ordinances as well is, you know, even though, you know, the five of us board members and Therese and the help from the community in putting this together, you know, our definitions today, you know, could be different than futuristic, you know, it could be a completely different select board, you know, down the road and administration. I know our opinion on this ordinance is, you know, these would just be the gross, negligent, very large scale issues. You know, this is not a, you know, two neighbors fighting over, you know, small stuff. You know, this would be, you know, that all complaints would come into Therese at the town manager's office, and then at that point there would be a determination of, you know, is this a nuisance that needs to be moved forward, or is this, you know, something that we would just squash locally. I didn't have anything else on the ordinance itself. It's pretty self-explanatory with the handout. Sure, Rick will open it up for questions.
Okay, technically, because what is in the report here, and also what was warned in the warning is not correct, stating an act that we will enact this today. So what we'll need to do, I'll read the article as it's stated. We're going to need to amend the article to make it just an advisory, and the last part of it about it being enacted within 10 days would be eliminated. So the article is written. Article 17, shall the voters enact the ordinance regulating control of garbage, trash, litter, and solid waste to protect public health, safety, and well-being, and to promote the responsible use of resources along with protection of the environment. Said ordinance, once approved, will be effective 10 days from today, March 3rd, 2020, and the full text of the ordinance may be found on the town website. First, let's have a motion, and a second to move the article. We'll correct it next. So we'll need a motion. Carl, you're making the motion. Do we have a second? Davis, thank you. So, motion,
sir?
Yes, sir.
Now, when we amend it, this should move to other business.
We could do suspend the rules and do that.
It's just, right. It's no longer binding.
Right.
Technically, it would fall under business.
Technically, you're right. It'd just be an advisory. Okay. So you're still going to be moving?
Yeah, I just wanted to understand.
Yep, no, great. Okay, Davis is seconded. Let me just, I know it's a little mundane here, but let me read it just to make sure we're doing everything correct. Article 17, shall the voters enact the ordinance regulating control of garbage, trash, litter, and solid waste to protect public health, safety, and well-being, and to promote the responsible use of resources along with protection of the environment. Said ordinance, once approved, will be effective 10 days from today, March 3rd, 2020. So that is on the floor. Now we're going to amend it. Shall the voters, how about favor?
Yeah,
or
the voters. I mean, I don't know if you have to shall, but basically you have to get rid of enact.
Right.
So it'd be favor, and then you'd have to strike out said ordinance on.
Okay. So I'll read. So it's, we'll replace it with shall the voters favor the ordinance regulating the control of garbage, trash, litter, and solid waste to protect public health, safety, and well-being, and to promote the responsibility of resources or responsible use of resources along with protection of the environment.
Period.
Okay. All right. Carl has made that motion to amend as we just stated. Is there a second on that? Davis is seconding. Okay. Do we have a discussion on that amendment? All those in favor of amending the article to read, shall the voters favor the ordinance regulating control of garbage, trash, and litter, and solid waste to protect public health, safety, and well-being, and to promote the responsible use of resources along with protection of the environment? Respond by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, now we can discuss the ordinance, proposed ordinance, if you so wish.
Chris, with all due respect, your capacity and ability to manage your own property stops when it impacts my health and welfare. And so when there are issues that fall before the common good, I respectfully submit that we have and should enact appropriate legislation to protect the common good and the welfare of all citizens.
Very good. Any other opinions on this?
I want to just add to Gene's comment and the future of current generations to come, that, you know, we need to think about the next group of children who are going to grow up, and we want them to have a healthy environment.
Any further comments?
I have some questions about this.
Sorry,
Rebecca Best.
Thank you.
But please never call me Rebecca, because stay with Becky. So I have some questions for you guys about this. First of all, it costs money to get rid of garbage. So this seems like it could, as much as I hate having neighbors with big piles of garbage too, and obviously no one likes that. However, devil's advocate, it costs money to get rid of garbage. How can you pass an ordinance that is going to unfairly burden low-income people? Second question. We have 400 feet of road frontage on our property. A good section of that is very, very vertical. And unfortunately, it's not visible from the house. Lots of people throw lots of garbage over our bank, and it goes a pretty long way from the road. Am I now responsible for walking that section of road and picking up every bit of litter? I recognize maybe this board is not going to come after me for that, but you can't guarantee what the board is going to be in the future. And whenever you pass an ordinance, you have to think about how might this be abused in the future? Not just how can it be used for good now. Thank you.
Thank you, Becky. Very good points. Further comments?
Carol Sears. In general, I agree with this ordinance, and I don't think it goes far enough. So I would like to see it extended in the future to other things such as automobiles and trailers that haven't been used in 20, 30 years. But I do have a question on number 10, the definition of solid waste, what that means. In the middle of it, it says definition does not include solid or dissolved materials in domestic sewage, yada, 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 until you get to tires. What does that mean? Is there an ordinance elsewhere for that? Is that affecting water sources? Can someone explain whether that's totally exempt or whether it is applicable elsewhere?
So domestic sewage is dealt with in our sewer ordinance. So if you were in the village and you already had sewer at your home, then the sewer ordinance would cover that. As far as if you are implying that maybe someone was getting rid of other solid waste materials in the sewer, then that definitely would be a state matter. Just like junk cars, there was a state ordinance and state laws for junk cars as well.
So I understand that what we're going to be voting on today is really, it's a sense of the community. That's what you're looking for, right? I'm going to vote on that, and that's going to go back with whatever result that is to the board. And I guess my concern, number one, I am in favor of the ordinance, but my concern is how this is going to be operationalized and whether the board has criteria set that are kind of higher fidelity criteria than what we're reading there, so that if you go out to a property and you take a look, it's a very subjective thing. Are these things going to be defined? Because it's similar to Becky, I mean, I do have concerns about how this could be interpreted with art that's in the yard, with farms that might have a special circumstance. So I understand the tone and tenor of the ordinance, and again, I do support it, but I think it's really incredibly important to have some well-defined and established criteria that are transparently offered to the community so that we have a sense of what is actually being enforced.
Okay, thank you, Todd.
So Todd, I think that part of it is definitely us, you're right, trying to define trash, which is the way we were trying to do it within the ordinance, so that it's hard because you're right, some of it is subjective. A lot of the, you know, ordinances in the town, any town, are subjective. So the goal was basically just to clean up, you know, bags and piles of garbage that were on properties that have rats that are going to other properties, that sort of thing. So I think that if you have suggestions on ways that we could adjust maybe the language, that's certainly why we had it out for a while, and we did read several ordinances to try to control that. My feeling is that of a board which is trying to just enforce the really big issues, not everyday things. Like Becky has a great point. We do have places where unfortunately people are doing illegal dumping, and get a hold of me, Becky. We've been trying to clean those areas up and also give signage to put there so people aren't doing that. I certainly agree with Becky. I'm not going to be looking at her being responsible for illegal dumping. There's state laws that cover illegal dumping, and that's where that belongs. So it's hard, Todd, you're right. There's the tenor of it. But for us, I think it was trying to wade into it and being judicious. And I'm certainly not going to go out and clean up, have someone clean up every little thing. But something that affects neighbors and that they can approve that, or prove that to us, then that would be what we would focus on. But any suggestions for a specific wording for the board formally adopts would be great. Thank you.
Gene Krause, a suggested operational language might be something like that would reasonably be construed as affecting the health or welfare of a person off of the property.
Okay, thanks for that suggestion. We have further comments. Some good discussion here. Oh, come on, Bob.
Bob Taylor, I don't need to vote.
Some people can't hear that well.
I'm just looking at, I have antique farm equipment out in my field. I think it looks really nice, but is the board in the future going to think that that's not appealing to people and they're going to want me to get rid of that? Right. That's just another idea.
Everybody hear that? Concerning yeah. Farm equipment?
Yeah.
Bob Tabor was concerned because he has some older farm equipment in his fields that he kind of likes the look of, but will that be maybe in the future considered as junk that needs to be removed?
Hold on just a second. We'll have one response to this question, and then
just to respond back to that. So the initial ordinance that we had, you know, the first draft of a draft that we were going through would have, you know, some limitabilities of things you were talking about, like, you know, I don't know, if you had a bathtub with flowers in it or something, I don't know. But this one here, we're just dealing with just trash and litter only. So if you had a metal object in your field, it wouldn't be part of this. This is biodegradable trash, litter that would, you know, that would be put in a trash bag, not anything, steel object or things like that.
Yes?
Nancy Pageley. I wanted to go back to Becky's first point about the cost, that for some people, perhaps this is the real problem, is they don't have the means to get rid of it, maybe they don't have a pickup truck, whatever. It might be an opportunity for a great community service project to get kids involved too, that if you do find a home where this is totally out of control, perhaps it's somebody that just isn't capable of doing it, and maybe we could have some kind of a sign up where people that do have pickup trucks or, you know, do have kids that would like to be involved in a community service project.
Okay, thank you. Question? Yes, sir.
Nancy, I think that's a great idea, and I also think that Becky's original point that she brought up is worth responding to, that we did actually discuss this in the original, and included in the enforcement portion, we included some language specifically to address that if somebody were to have an issue paying for the removal themselves, that there's a line in here right at the end, the owner has the right to meet with the town manager to establish a plan, so not even a payment plan, but just a plan to have all items removed. So we were considering that in dealing with this.
Can you reference where that is, Lindley?
It's section 3 under enforcement, the last line of item A.
Carl Russell, I was also just going to point that out. They, in under definitions, they have abatement of cost, talking about the abatement of the labor, equipment, or supplies, contract price of any charges to the town in respect to removal, disposal of garbage, trash, or the like from the property. So in the case of an appeal, it seems like there's an opportunity in this ordinance for people to say, it's here, I can't deal with it, and let's make a plan, and can the town abate these costs? So it seems like there's a possibility for a solution there.
All right, Carl, thanks for bringing that up. Yep. Anyone else? And again, remember, this is just an advisory vote that we will take here. I'm assuming there'll be, yep.
I just wanted one last comment. I wanted to follow back up to the first comment that was made, which was in regards to my comment. My comment was solely based upon showing the taxpayers of the town that our board is transparent. We're not here with an agenda item ourselves. Even though I have my own feelings on this particular piece, that we're not here to just push the will of our own agendas. So I think that's one good thing about our board here, is we have the authority and the power to do that. What we've chosen to do, which I feel is a more responsible way of doing it, is to get complete buy-in from the community of, is this favorable or not? Or if it's not, what can we do? And then enact something. So I guess I didn't want my comments to be construed. It was really more just a, hey, this is my opinion. However, I'm not here as a select board member to just enact my opinions in the community. It's the whole big body, so just wanted to clear those. Thanks.
Yep. Procedurally, since how we're just doing an advisory vote today, I'm assuming that you will probably make another draft of this and have more hearings. Is that correct? So there'll be more input available or no?
I think if there's not a lot of changes to this, this ordinance will go as is on a future select board agenda, and the select board will pass it. It gets put in the newspaper, and this very specific policy, or not policy, process laid out in state statute on how an ordinance is passed. But it is on the website currently. It has been for a while that we've been looking for input. So it will come out, and then once it's published and that goes, there is time for appeals and for people to go through it. And that process is clearly laid out.
Great. Thanks, Therese. And so what our advisory vote will be on is as this is printed. So if you are in favor of this as it's printed, then you would want to vote for it. If you have some problems with any parts, then you would vote no. Okay, is everyone clear on that? And again, it's advisory, but it sounds like they're going to pretty well take what comes out of this meeting today and go forward.
Point of order, I just want to clarify what you just said. We're voting on the article as amended, which refers to the ordinance as printed.
Right. Correct. Right. So that's why I was wanted to make that clear. That most likely it'll be pretty much what you see here. Unless there's future petitions against it. So further comments or questions? If not, I will read it one more time and we'll attempt to do this with a voice vote. Article 17, shall the voters favor the ordinance regarding control of garbage, trash, litter, and solid waste to protect public health, safety, and well-being, and to promote the responsible use of resources along with the protection of the environment? All those in favor of the advisory Article 17, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed say no.
No.
The ayes appear to have it. And the ayes do, yes.
Based on
the
division of
health.
Yep.
You want to do a hand vote?
Okay,
we have a request to do a hand vote. All those in favor, raise your hand. Okay, all those opposed? So I will say again, in the eyes of the moderator, the eyes have it, appear to have it, unless we want to go to a ballot, but seems to be pretty well one way. So Article 17 has passed as an advisory to the select board. Mm-hmm. Lastly, Article 18, and before we get to the end of this, I do want to, Sandy, is there still pies out there? Okay. Muffins, cookies, so don't leave on an empty stomach. You can ruin your lunch, it's okay. Go take some stuff home. So, Article 18, to transact any other non-binding business that may legally come before the meeting pursuant to 17 BSA 2660. Is there any further business? I will just say that from the studies that have been done, and even going to Australian ballot, participation really doesn't change that much. I don't want to affect anybody's opinion, but just from what I've seen, and the town meeting committee has done some research on that, it really doesn't change a whole lot. But I understand it's people's right to move the meeting whenever they'd like.
I think it's important to note that under state statute, employees have the right to petition their employers to give town meeting day off. If we move the meeting to another point in time, that may not be the case for many other people.
Ah, good point. Yep. So I don't know if you are aware of that, and we do, the town meeting committee does try to make that. I'm not sure if we made it in here this year. I think it did, though. You are allowed to petition to request from your employer to have the day off. Granted, you have to do it in advance. You can't just show up Tuesday morning and say, I'm taking the day off. But you have state law that allows you to do that. So you have that option. Yep. Can you come to the microphone?
Well, they'll give you the day off. It's just you don't get paid to not be there.
Okay.
You know, you're losing time. And, you know, it's a local business. I'd hate to have them shut down so that everybody can go to their town meeting.
Okay, Jen is saying that you may be able to get the day off, but you may not get paid for it. And also businesses in town do shut down for a few hours, and they would have to do that if it was in the evening. So something to consider. There is a process that could be done if you wanted to do that. And Therese can guide you through that if that's something that you wanted to do in the future. Any further points to be brought up?
Gene Krause. I would encourage people to pay attention to climate change. It is an existential crisis. We need to pay attention to it in the way we run and operate our local communities as well as our personal lives. There is an organization called the Randolph Area Climate Alliance that is working, and it includes Bethel in its coverage area, and it is working on that subject. I would encourage people to be aware and supportive of any and all efforts to address that issue.
Thank you, Gene. Very good.
Moderator.
Yes.
Move we adjourn.
There's a motion to adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor to adjourn the meeting, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.